2 Corinthians chapter 9, we want to continue our series this month, the idea of being thankful. And obviously, it's the time of year we talk about that, but we wanted to take it far beyond, if you remember from last week, beyond just I'm thankful for my food and I'm thankful for my friends and I'm thankful for my family. Those three F's we can rattle off very quickly, but to go far beyond that. We talked about in Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 20, that we talked about giving thanks to God the Father at all times for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We talked about that we're called to give thanks. That is a command from God. It's not an option. It's not something we can do if we feel like it or want to. He says we are called to be a people who give thanks. Give thanks for what? To give thanks for all things at all times. An important phrase to think about, that we're called to give thanks at all times for all things. That is a challenge to do. Let's be honest, if we're really honest. The third thing is, where are we to be thankful and to who do we be thankful? Obviously, we're thankful for so much here this way horizontally, but vertically, we're called to be thankful to God the Father, thankful for the Lord Jesus Christ who came and died on this earth for you and for me. Thankful at all times and all things. We'll talk about it as we work through this series. But we talked about last week being thankful for our story, that all of us have a story. It's a story that God is writing. We trust that God is writing that story. And really challenge you last week, you take time this week, and some of you did, because a couple of you emailed me or told me this morning, hey, I wrote my story, or I've already shared my story. We challenge you to just to spend time writing your story. What has God done in your life? We talked about what God has done before you met Christ and how you realized you needed Christ and how you found Christ. And then what is Christ doing in your life right now? That you would be challenged to share that very truth with somebody this month. And now if you do, I hope you'll write me an email. It encourages me. It lets me know, hey, somebody's listening. Somebody's doing what it is that we're called to do. And we realize, too, by this assessment, that some of you are sharing Christ. And I'm rejoicing in that. But the vast majority of us are not sharing Christ very often. And we'll be called to simply share our story. The second thing we want to talk about in this thankful this time is our season to share. I am thankful for my story that God has given me, unique to me. Your story is unique to you. But I'm secondly this time, I am thankful for my season to share. Now, we know it's really that time of year. We talk about sharing and giving. We talk about it often because it's this time of year we seem to talk about that. But my prayer is that we would go far beyond just being thankful at Thanksgiving. We go far beyond just sharing at Christmas or at Thanksgiving, but it will be something that we do all the time. It becomes part of our DNA. It becomes part of the DNA of our church family that we give and we share all the time of who we are and of who Christ is and what He has done in our lives. Now, no doubt, and we'll talk about some of those opportunities right in front of us we can do, but I want to take it far beyond that. We'd be willing to be people and Christ's followers who understand that it is always our season to share. You thought about that? It's always. When is the right time to be thankful? Today. When is the right time to be thankful? Next month, next year. When is the time to share? Today. When is the time to share? Next month, right? It's all the time. It's part of who we are. I want us to look at a passage that Paul wrote to the Corinthians, and really maybe a fresh perspective, maybe an encouragement to us that we would give that which God has so richly given to us. God had enriched the Corinthians in an amazing way, and a matter of fact, they had said, hey, we're going to give, but they had not yet done so. So it seems strange that really when you stop and think about it, why would a Christian need an encouragement to give? Why is it we have to have this conversation? Because really by nature, as a Christ follower, we recognize that which Christ has given to us. Therefore, we are called to do the same. We're called to give. We're called to share of what God has given us. So Paul gives us some tremendous words I think will really, really help us. If you have your Bibles open, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning in verse number 1. I'm going to read the whole chapter, so I'll let you be seated this morning. Read this whole chapter to you this morning. I think it will really bless you. Here's what it says. For it is superfluous for me to write to you, or superfluous, I guess is the right way to say that word, isn't it? That's a good word. Well, I butchered that word. For me to write to you about this ministry to the saints. For I know your readiness, of which I boast about to you to the Macedonians, namely, that an Achaia has been prepared since last year, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I have sent the brethren that our boasting about you may not be made empty in this case, that as I was saying, you may be prepared. Lest if any Macedonians come with me and find you unprepared, we, not to speak of you, should be put to shame by this confidence. So I thought it necessary to urge you, brethren, that they would go on ahead to you and arrange beforehand your previously promised bountiful gift, that the same might be ready as a bountiful gift and not be affected by covetousness. Now, this I say to you, he who sows sparingly shall also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Let each one do just as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. As it is written, he quotes from Proverbs here, he who scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, he gave to the poor, his righteousness abides forever. Now he, God the Father, who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food, will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in everything for all your liberality, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only fully supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing through many thanksgiving to God. Because of the proof given by this ministry, they will glorify God for your obedience to your confession of the gospel of Christ and for the liberality of your contribution to them and to all. While they also, by prayer on your behalf, yearn for you because of the surpassing grace of God in you. In this last verse, verse 15, it's not up here, but listen to what it says. If you have your Bibles, I want you to read it with me, whatever translation you have. Verse 15 says, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Hello, that is a great word. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Can we just say that scripture together? Now let's say it together. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. And what is that gift, church? Jesus. We, of all people, should be the most thankful of all. Jesus Christ was given the most indescribable gift ever. Paul gives some wonderful words, some words I'd never thought about in relation to giving. And I'll be honest with you, I love to talk about giving. I told you this a few weeks ago in our transformation series, and here it's come up again. I just love to talk about giving. Because I believe it's true. We are never more like Christ than when we give. It's just the truth. And I don't mean just monetarily. I mean far beyond that, of giving of our lives, of giving of our resources, of giving of our talents. And yes, sometimes even giving of our financial resources. I want you to think about some things that your giving will do, why I'm thankful, and why it will be good for you and I as a church family. Number one, notice this. Your giving will encourage and exhort others to give. In Acts chapter 20, verse 35, Paul says, Luke says, I have given you an example that by working hard like this, we should help the weak. We should remember the words that the Lord Jesus said, giving gifts is more satisfying than receiving them. Now, what is interesting to note here is if we stop and think, if you go back to Matthew chapter 6, this is the beauty of taking the whole counsel of the Word of God. And Matthew chapter 6 says, when you give, what? Give in what? Cheerfully. But in Matthew 6, he says, give secretly, give privately, he says in Matthew 6. But here he says that my giving will encourage and exhort others. So that means they have to know that I'm giving, right? So what is the balance here? Well, here's the balance. There are times when it would be good for others to know where we invest our dollars. Doesn't mean we tell how much that we give, right? The Lord Jesus was the only one who knew that the widow gave the two mites and that the Pharisees gave not anything in comparison to what she gave, right? The Lord knew what they'd given. It's why one of the reasons when I share with you, when we come to a time like Lottie Moon Christmas offering, I want you to know, I'm not doing it from a bragging standpoint at all whatsoever, but I want you to know if I'm asking you to give sacrificially, that this preacher is going to give sacrificially. And I hope that my encouragement will encourage you to give. Did you know that when you talk about the fact that you give, not how much you give, but the fact that you give will encourage somebody else to give. And in fact, talking about giving will help. One of the testimonies from our cardboard testimony, somebody said, I didn't know about giving a tithe. Nobody told me. And now that I know, I've been so blessed by seeing that happen in my life of God literally fulfilling this text right before their very eyes. So did you, I don't know if you stopped and thought about it. My giving can encourage and exhort, which means to, I mean strongly encourage others to give and be energized to give, to see the point of giving, to see the value of giving. That's why we teach our children when they're young to understand the value of giving. That's why I love something like an Operation Christmas Child, because it goes far beyond, though that's a great thing in and of itself, hear me, by all means, but it teaches them the value of going into a store, which is hard to do with a 7 and a 9-year-old. Y'all don't experience it so far. To go into Dollar General, Walmart, and not buy something for themselves. Well, I want that. Well, praise God, that's not why we're here, right? We're here for somebody else. That's a valuable lesson, because all our kids know, for the most part, is, truth now, I go and I ask, and I get what I want. Now, some of you say, well, I don't do that to my kids. Oh, yes, you do. You may not do it every time, but you do it sometimes. We all do it. But in these moments, we teach them, we encourage, we energize them, we help them understand the value of giving and the beauty of what it means to give and to bring that shoebox and then get a letter from a little kid in Pakistan who says, hey, thank you for giving. I wouldn't have had Christmas had you not sent me something. And then to understand the value of giving. So your giving, my giving, will energize and encourage others. Secondly, notice this. Your own giving, watch this, will enrich your life. This is one of the greatest secrets of giving, because in our minds we think, if I give, then I won't have something. That's what Satan tells you. When I look, if you give now, you may not have enough for yourself. You may not have enough for your family. You may not have enough for this or have enough for that. Well, that seems kind of logical, doesn't it? But the reality is, the gospel is if you go backwards in that way, it's not the way the world operates. In fact, the more you give, the more you get. Now, let that sit just a second. I've rarely heard this scripture taught, especially when we start talking about sowing the seed. You hear that on TV a lot. Sow that seed gift and God will multiply. You give 100, God will make it 1,000. You ever heard that one? And I just go, time out. That is not in the scripture. Whoop, not there. Show it to me. I see the part about sowing the seed, but I don't see where it says if I give 100, God will turn it into 1,000. God does promise to bless us and to bless us bountifully. But blessing bountifully does not necessarily mean, it can, but it does not necessarily mean we are blessed financially. But if you've ever had the opportunity to go and to serve somewhere, and I can think of Shekinah Glory, which, by the way, if you help on that trip, we're going to do another trip. I met with Brother Carl Twiner from Shekinah Glory. They're in that sanctuary. And to go back in that room and see the pews there and the wood floors down and the carpet, and then look at us and say, we really want your church to come be a part of it with us. There was only about 10 or 12 of us that went. But, well, we got to go and serve and sweat and give. Why? And who got the blessing? Well, they got the building. We didn't get the building. But we went home knowing that we have been obedient to the call of God. And we met some friends and we'll have for life. It's in Northside Drive. It's on another side of town that normally we wouldn't go to. Let's just be honest. But now we've obeyed Christ's call and we have a fulfillment of coming home tired and weary and stinky and dirty and nasty and coming home and knowing we helped the church get in the building so they can help others get into church. And since we've been gone, they've added 15 new members, those who did not know Christ. And guess who had a part in that? We did. Hello. Good, I'm the only one who gets excited about that. Good night. All we did was help put sheetrock in the bathroom. Well, praise God, the same people have a toilet. Wouldn't you like to have one? They had to go all the way outside the building, up the stairs. Now they have one in their sanctuary right close by. I get excited about this. I've warned you. Your giving will enrich your life. Look what Luke 6:38 says. Give to others and God will give to you. It's a biblical principle. Indeed, you'll receive a full measure, a generous helping, pouring into your hands all that you can hold and even more. The measure you use for others, we love to leave this scripture out for sure. The measure you use for others is the one that God will also use for you. Okay, I like the first part of that verse. Help it overflow. But now what he says is, I'm going to bless you in proportion to how you're blessing others. Sometimes we wonder, why am I seeming to miss something? Why is my walk not where I want it to be? Sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes it's because we're not giving the way God wants us to give. Your giving will enrich life. Warren Wiersbe says, giving is not something we do, it is something that we are. Giving is a way of life for the Christian who understands the grace of God. Notice one, three principles quickly about this, about giving. Number one, the principle of increase. The principle of increase. What do we see here? In verse number 6, he says, remember this, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but he who plants generously will get a generous crop. Now, this is not very difficult to understand. If you put in 20 seeds, you're going to get some crop. If you put in 200 seeds, you're going to get more. If you put in 2,000 seeds, you're going to get a crop. Now, I never understood this until I planted seeds. Now, I grew up as a city boy, but I was in Alabama, and I got to get on those little machines that was you push in a row. And they put little seeds in the bottom. Matthew, you remember we did this for Mr. Billy, and we got in there, we got the seeds, and we pushed it down the row. And I watched the seeds pour out, and I say, oh, if some extras fell out, do I need to just make sure one seed? He says, no, we're going to sow much so we can reap much. I have some in my freezer of reaping the benefit of that. Peas and butter beans. Pepper sauce. Why? Because I put it in the ground. If I only put in 4 seeds, I'm not going to get much. Listen, sometimes we don't realize in our own minds why what's happening. We don't have the right principle of understanding of increase. What I sow, that will I reap. If I invest a little money, I only get a little bit back. The more I invest in eternal things, the more rewards I build both in heaven to come and even some here right now. Proverbs 3, 9, and 10. Honor God with everything you own. Give him the first and the best. Your barns will burst. Your wine vats will brim over, it says. The principle of increase. Secondly, the principle of intent. Now, I can give, but I can give with a cruddy attitude. And I've met people like that. And you have too. Here you go. God bless you. You don't deserve it, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. Right? We feel like with our kids sometimes, maybe, here it is, I'm just going to give it to you. No, 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 what does God say here? That's why I love an offering that is exciting. Now, I love it, it can be reverent, but I love an offering that we're pumped up, we're excited, that we are jazzed up, that we get to give to the Lord. I love it. The Bible says here, you know what the real translation of this word is? Be an hilarious giver. That's what the word cheerful means. So as I'm giving, I'm laughing all the way to the bank, if you will, at the devil going, ha, ha, ha. I've given to God because I want to, not because I have to, because I should or I ought to. I give because I want to give. I'm giving out the blessing God's given me. And hello, Satan, I'm going to give it cheerfully. I don't want my kids to see me put an offering. I'm not going there. Boy, I sure could use that money. Now, once a year, I allow myself to look at that money and think to myself, just one time a year. We get our statements every year. D mails out the statements from the church office. We give what you give. Next year, we're going to do it 4 times a year. Like that. Isn't that good? Oh, 4 times a year so you can kind of keep up with where you are. And so you kind of give what you give. And I look at that one time a year and I go, whew, I could have done something with all that money. Oh, from the fleshly side. So how unspiritual, preacher. Really? Come on. I mean, you think it, and so do I. I'm just like you for a split second. And then I get all excited. And I think about, look what all that God would have done with what I gave if I had not given. And then I get to go overseas, or I get to be a part of a conference and meet a missionary, or do something, and I see and I understand. I go, oh, that's why I gave. Or I see a baptistry full of children or teenagers or adults who came to know Christ, and I go, that's why I gave. I'm the one who's blessed. The principle of intent. I got to decide in my heart how much I give. I got to give cheerfully. John MacArthur says, while it is possible to give without loving, it is not possible to love without giving. Ooh, did you hear that one? But I wish I came up with that one. I didn't. Let me say it to you again. Listen to what it says again. While it is possible to give without loving, it is. It is not possible to love. In other words, to be radically committed, sold out to Christ without giving. The principle of immediacy. What does the Bible tell us here? Sometimes, while we're happening it, God will bless us right on the spot. He'll bless us right on the spot. Sometimes we're not even through sowing, and we begin to reap. What does he say here? We're going to sow. He says, you're going to have all things. You'll have all sufficiency. You'll have everything that you need. Always these big words to say, God's going to take care of you. And sometimes it'll be an immediate thing of my presence, of a special touch of my heart on yours, and a special blessing on the church you're a part of. Folks, why do you think it is that God is blessing Petal First Baptist? Have you stopped and asked that question? And if you answer the preacher, Oh, don't you answer the preacher. It's not about the preacher. It's about what God is doing in this place. And God forbid if you ever say it's the preacher. Amen. Thank you. Now I want to be a vessel that God used. Hear my heart. I don't want you going away. That, oh, sorry, preacher. I hate that guy. Good grief. I don't want you saying that. Now hear me. But what I want us to be able to say is this what you are doing as you pray, as you give, as you go, as we do it together, then God will bless. You've begun to, we're not there yet, but you've begun to untie the strings of the purses in your wallets and begin to give. How do we know that? Because our giving has increased substantially over it was 2 years ago. God will bless that church. God will bless a church that gives away more than it gets. So then God can bless you with more. Think about it. If my hands are full, why does, oh, I love the Holy Spirit when he does this. If your hands are full, why does God need to put anything else in your hands? Hello. Why are some churches struggling to reach? We're not there yet, church. We've got a long way to go. We've made strides. Why? Because they're holding on to all the blessings. We got to give them away and give them away and give them away. I got to hurry. Y'all not listening fast enough. Here we go. Your giving will encourage thanksgiving to the Lord. Your encouragement. Did you realize that you can make somebody else be thankful to the Lord? Listen to what it says in the end of verse 11, the end of verse 12. And when you take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God. Not you, but God. And they will joyfully express their thanks to God. I can think of a family in a church I served in previously. And they had came upon a financial need. Something unexpected happened. I mean, just catastrophic. And there was another member in our church who found out about it, who had the financial means to help meet that need. They called me up that Sunday. They found out about it. And said, listen, we want to meet that need. My wife and I, we've prayed. And we want to help them get over the hump for a couple of weeks until he can get back on his feet. But we don't want to know who did it. We just want to give it to you and you. And I say, I get to take it? Are you kidding me? Wow. I'm like, do you mind? Oh, no, I don't mind. No, I don't mind. In fact, I'll come right now and get it. So I got that gift and I took it to them and I said, listen, God has answered your prayer today. Here is the financial gift. You know what they did? They didn't say, well, who gave it? Where'd it come from? They fell on their knees and began to weep and say, thank you, God. Your giving will encourage others to thank God. Some other scriptures we don't have time to look at. Notice this next one. Your giving will ease others' needs. Their giving was going to help provide for the needs of the saints in Jerusalem. They had needs of their own church. There's no question, but they were giving as sacrificially now that which God had given them to bless the others who were worse off than they were. And it was going to help ease their needs. Hebrews 13, 16. Do not forget to do good for the things for others and to share what you have with them. These are the kind of sacrifices that please God. Romans 12, 13. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. God is putting before our church and before you incredible opportunities to bless somebody. I want to encourage you to do it. Notice these last three quickly. Your giving will exalt God. Verse 13 says, as a result of your ministry, they will give glory to God. For your generosity to them and to all believers will prove. Watch, did you hear that? Hello. And to all believers will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ. Not only will you give them, help them be thankful, but it will prove to them and show them you're a Christ follower, and it will bring glory to God. Why are you and I on planet Earth? Why did God put you here? Why did God put me here? Let me tell you why in case you don't know. Isaiah 28, 26, verse 8 says, indeed, while following in the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you earnestly. For your name and your renown, your honor, your glory is the desire of our souls. Folks, we are here to make God's name great and our name nothing. Pedal First Baptist name, nothing but to make God's name great to the Songhai Sakadao, to those in Cleveland, Ohio, to those in Jackson, Mississippi, to those in Pedal, Mississippi, and right inside the shadow of this steeple, that they may know that God's name is great and his glory is great. That's what our thankfulness in giving will do. That's why you're here. There's a story told, a guy told about a wealthy Christian who daily at family devotions prayed with his family that the needs of the missionaries would be met. A little boy one day after the prayers got through, he said, "Dad, if I had your checkbooks, I could answer your prayers." Hello. Your giving will elicit prayer. Your giving will elicit prayer. What do you mean? It will encourage others to pray for you. Do you know what? You know, there are two churches that were not praying for us that are now praying for Petal First Baptist. Did you know that? There are some missionaries that we had not met until a year and a half ago who are praying for our church that were not before. Mount Vernon Missionary Baptist Church, we're considered sister churches. The world says, wait, sister, it does work in God's kingdom. Shekinah Glory is praying for Petal First Baptist. And we're doing the same, of course. Why? Because we gave. And when you give, people look at that and say, man, I want to pray for you. Now, sometimes people come to you and say, I need you to pray for me. And we go, okay, I'll pray for you. Sure, no problem. Well, let's be honest. Do you always pray for them? I see some smiles. We mean well. It's almost like, how are you doing? Fine. I'll pray for you. It's about the same thing with Christians. It's the Christianese we speak. I'll pray for you. Sure, I'll pray for your brother. Can I give you a word of encouragement? I learned something about 10 years ago. I wish I'd learned it a long time ago before that. Maybe even longer than that, 12, 13 years ago. I learned it from another pastor of mine. When somebody comes to you and says, I have a need in my life, can I give you a word of encouragement? And this will bless. And it needs to be not something we plan. In a life group, somebody brings up a prayer request, and I don't mean like the kind without Sally's, Susan's, friends, dogs, cat, ran over the frog kind of deal, okay, you with me? I'm not talking about that kind. I'm talking about in their own personal life, or somebody close to them is struggling, and you, life group leader, you stop that class right then and right there. So let's stop and pray right now. Let's just surround them. Let's pray them right now. Or somebody calls you on the phone and says, I don't know what to do. I'm blah, 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 goes the whole scenario. Hey, let's stop and pray right now. Walking through the hallway of this building, somebody's struggling. You can see it on their face. Don't just stop and say, well, I'm going to do something about it. Stop and pray right then. Why wait? Pray. Notice the last. Your giving will express and exemplify the heart of God. Thank God for this gift, too wonderful for words. John 3:16. Hello, the greatest giver, for God so loved the world. Romans 8:32, since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give up everything else? 1 John 4:9-10, this is how God showed love to us. And he sent his one and only son into the world so that we could have life through him. This is what real love is. It is not our love for God, it is God's love for us, sending his son to be the way to take away our sins. And I want to encourage you. Some of you would say, I'm just not in a place financially where I can do that. There are moments and seasons of our life where we can. And there's measured. Remember, the widow with two mites gave two, not even worth a penny. But she gave. And it's not always measured. It's not measured, not always. It's never measured by how much we give. It's measured by the sacrifice of our heart. That's why we don't line up everybody up here and say, hey, they didn't give a whole lot, but boy, they gave a lot. Let's brag on them. Let's lift them up on a pedestal. That's why we keep our giving private. Why? So that nobody gets on the glory, that all the honor going goes to God. Because you know what? If you get the glory, guess what? Guess what? You got all you're going to get. There is no reward for you beyond that recognition. We want to do it privately. We can let others know we give. So that's why next Sunday morning, we're going to take our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes and bring them down to the altar during the invitation, or as you arrive, whichever, whenever you get here, however you want to do it, we're going to bring them to the altar. Why? It encourages each other. Hey, we gave. I can hardly wait. Dollar General and Walmart will be sold out of stuff this week. It is unbelievable. You better hurry up and go. It's running out already, I can tell you. Encourages others to give. Four ways you can give right here, right now. And then we'll go far beyond this. Or maybe there's five. Number one, I'm going to get those in a second. Let me encourage this. You can give the best gift of all is give your heart and life to Jesus Christ. That's the greatest gift you can give. You can join this church family. You can be a part of sharing your life with somebody else. You can give to our church ministry plan, our 2014 church ministry plan. You give that every single week. You can give, whether here or online, however you choose to do that, you can give. You can give a Operation Christmas Child shoebox, and we learned how to pack it last week from Uncle Si, thank goodness, on how to pack a shoebox. We got 270 boxes out so far. Our goal is 300. I'm praying we go way over 300. Simple, something so simple. It'll cost you about roughly, we spend about $25, $30 roughly a box. That's in that little box. It's big enough for a mouse, as Uncle Si said. We can't shove a whole lot in there. But what an investment. We couldn't get them this year, but next year you're going to get to meet somebody, and you may have already met this guy, lives in Petal, who was a recipient of a shoebox years ago. Couldn't come this year, but next year you're going to hear his story, and that's all I'm going to tell you. It's a blessing. Thanksgiving baskets, we can provide 125 cans of cranberry sauce. And you think to yourself, I do, okay? Because I don't like cranberry sauce. Yuck! So why is that going to bless somebody? We're going to go buy some cans of cranberry sauce. Why? Because it makes a Thanksgiving meal. But there's some families in our community who will not have Thanksgiving meal. They won't have a church family Thanksgiving meal to come to, most likely. And they won't be able to have one on Thursday, and Thanksgiving, the rest of us have one. And so we're going to help provide the Petal Children's Task Force with all the churches in our area to provide a complete meal. We don't need any more cornmeal. We got all that. Somebody donated all 125 bags in one fell swoop. But you can bring cans. You can bring those by November 23rd. Christmas Child Boxes, by the way, is next Sunday. Angel Tree Ministry, we set it up today. You can go and bless the lives of foster children in Forest County. Dee McDermott, her life group, they went this last week and served lunch to all the DHR workers. And you talk about a tough job. You don't know about a DHR worker, just come ask me. I'll tell you. They have a tough job. They deal with some of the worst situations you and I can possibly imagine. And Dee called them up and said, "Want to do lunch for?" They said, "Well, you want to do what for us?" Correct me if I'm wrong. She said, "Nobody has ever done this for us." Just served them pizza and salad and dessert, gave them a little gift. Just said, "Thank you for what you do." Blessing people. You can get an angel out there and help Christmas for a foster child who might not otherwise have it. They'll be on the tree right out here. You can grab them, and I think he's here. I know I saw Kevin. Your precious bride is here. I think I saw her here. She'll be out there to receive. There she is, right there. She'll be there to receive you, okay? And she can answer any questions you got. She knows all the details, all right? You can grab a tree. You can grab that too, I guess. Grab the whole thing at one time. Grab an angel. How many angels do we have? 20? Okay. Last year, we took 20 last year, didn't we? Yeah. So we might. Can we get more if we need more? Oh, we can. I like that. See, we need to do 25. We did 20 last year. We can do 25. Grab an angel. Or lastly, and my most important one, it's our ultimate Christmas offering. December the 14th, we'll bring our gift. We're going to talk about Lottie Moon in our offertory second in just a moment. But we want to bring our gift, a sacrificial gift that will go help those like the Sangal Sakadal and others around the earth who have never, ever, ever heard the name Jesus. In our people group, it is the name Isa Almasi, Jesus Christ, the Savior. Oh, I look forward to that day. We go way over $17,000. We help fund a missionary. We help buy Bibles. We help get transportation. Whatever it is, that gift will go towards. It's our season to share. And we get to do it hilariously. Would you join me?